Welcome to enjoythemusic.tv. Today's June 23rd, 2014, and I am here with Peter Qvortrup of Audio Notes UK. Oh, wow, look at that. Good morning, everyone, or afternoon or evening, depending on when you're watching this. We'd like to welcome Peter Qvortrup to our studio. Peter has done so many things, but most people know him as the head honcho at Audio Note UK. Good morning, Peter.
Good morning, Steve.
Oh, so we've known each other for about 20.
Happy today.
Oh, yes. Well, you know, life is good. Life is good. Now, for those who've never heard the story, I actually first learned about Audio Note UK from a British magazine, and I was looking at an Odo. And the next thing I know, a Audio Note Ngaku was arriving at my front door. And that started my path down the single-ended tubes, which at that time, really nobody but you guys and maybe a couple others were doing single-ended vacuum tube. Why did Audio Note decide to seek this technology?
Well, I think it, I mean, there is a, Audio Note was in those days a Japanese company, and they basically, the tradition in Japan has been since the 1960s that the best sounding circuit topology is the single-ended. And since they also liked horns, then there wasn't such a big problem that there was very little power available. And, you know, I decided in 89 to bring that to out of Japan in a more sort of commercial fashion. It's arguable whether amplifiers at $89,000 are a commercial fashion, but there you are.
Absolutely. Now, another thing is...
That's a whole contention, right?
Well, Audio Note does more than amplifiers. You're one of the few manufacturers that make everything from turntables and digital source all the way to speakers. Now, why did you seek out a complete system solution?
Well, it's for two reasons, really. One, because I've spent a lot of time in the industry as an importer and as a retailer before I went into manufacturing and designing audio products. And I one of the things I always ran my head up against was the fact that it was very, very difficult to find pieces of equipment that worked together properly. And there was also always something that made it fall down. It was either the efficiency of the speakers or the impedance of the power amp didn't match the output impedance of the preamp, or there was some other issue that couldn't be identified. So what I decided fairly early on was that I wanted to eliminate all that and make my own. So we started making speakers and amplifiers, and eventually added DA converters and CD players, and then turntables and cartridges. And I very much hold the view that the idea that you can take five or six different manufacturers' products and get an optimal result out of combining what effectively amounts to very, very different design philosophies and ideas about how things should work is a little bit like, you know, buying a gearbox from a Mercedes and an engine from BMW and suspension from Audi and a chassis from somewhere else, and then trying
to mate them all together.
Yeah, and it just doesn't work. I mean, it's at its very best, you can probably achieve something slightly better than mediocrity. And at its worst, it's downright offensive, in my view, sonically. And I think what it does over time is it puts the customers off. Because the customer will try and change equipment. And at some point, they'll decide, I just can't get this to work properly. I'm going to give up and buy some jet skis or a yacht or better car or whatever it is. And then those customers, in most cases, are lost to the industry completely. I mean, I would say... probably a third of all our really big customers, the guys that buy at the top end of our range, they are customers that come to us having tried pretty much everything else and not succeeding in getting anything near the sound they were expecting or that they were promised by whatever reviews and so on that they've been reading about the various pieces of equipment. And they've listened to the manufacturer's excuses about why this wasn't working and why that wasn't working. And it's your room, it's your cables, you need a new power amp, you need to buy the latest version of the speaker because that's much better. And in that, we've solved all these problems. And in reality, none of it's true.
Well, it comes down to system synergy. I believe, just like with automobiles, and you're actually a kind of retired race car driver, as am I, is that it is a system and needs to work together to get the ultimate performance.
Yeah. I mean, I think that the synergy is, like I said when I started, that I don't think it's possible to combine 5, 6, 7, 8 products from different manufacturers to a system and achieve anything that's much better than mediocrity. Because that in most cases, the particular design philosophies and whatever else, technical understanding and so on, from the manufacturers, the individual manufacturers, it simply isn't sufficient. Because the speaker manufacturers will always blame, if they can't get their speakers to sound any good,
you blame the amplifier manufacturer.
Blame the amplifier. And the amplifier manufacturer will blame the speaker or the cable manufacturer or some other part of it. And it becomes for the end consumer, it becomes just an endless merry-go-round where they can just keep changing and keep changing and keep changing. And given that the middle classes that represents the majority of the specialized audio industry's customers is not getting any richer. And this also probably explains the explosion in outlandishly expensive products that are on the market now.
Oh, well, I know. I was at Munich about a month ago, and it's amazing how many $150,000, $200,000 products are out there now that were unheard of just a handful of years ago.
Well, I mean, when we came out with the Ongaku and some of the other products that Mr. Kondo made in Japan, we really defined the very, very top end of the market. And all that happened was that as we became successful with that, a lot of other manufacturers suddenly thought, hey, if they can sell something at these prices, maybe we can too. So suddenly you see this flood of product coming out that is at really very serious prices. Now, I've been manufacturing audio for a long time, and I can look at a product and I can tell you pretty much what it costs to make within a few percent. I can tell you quite categorically that it's very, very difficult to justify the prices that a lot of people charge.
Now, if we go...
A lot of people say that about us, but the fact of the matter is that at least in our products, 90% of the parts are only made for us.
Well, exactly. You've handmade components. Yeah. And another thing that I love, and that I loved about the Ongaku, is that besides its sheer weight, is I don't know how many pounds of silver. Audiono tends to use a lot of silver interconnects, and it's hand-wound silver transformers, although they do also make copper. What is it with the love of silver that you have with your upper-line products?
Well, unlike what a lot of people will tell you, we're not actually biased against anything. What I'm biased against is something that doesn't sound any good. And when you compare copper and silver in the right environment, then silver is far, far, far superior. And it's a very interesting experiment. We've done this experiment a number of times. But the best experiment you can do is that you wind two coils, output transformers, and you just leave them as bobbins without a core on them. And then you measure them. And there's the difference in measurements are negligible. So they're in the sort of 1 or 2%. Then you put cores on them. and then you measure them again. And again, the differences are minute. Okay. You know, they're so small, there's hardly any difference in phase, there's no difference in frequency response, there's no difference in efficiency or anything else. Then you put them in a preamp circuit, one in one channel, one in the other channel, and you just flick between on a mono signal, mm-hmm. you just flick between the two, and the difference is 200%. Now, there's clearly, because we can't measure these differences, people deny that they're there. Hmm. But that's bad science, in my view. The fact that you can establish something happening, and but you can't measure or work out why initially, that should then make you curious to find out what is happening.
Exactly.
Rather than just say, no, there is clearly no difference in sound. Whatever difference it is we're hearing, it is not interesting. That's not what we're looking for. And this is where the you know, you can do the same with silver wires. You can do the same with silver in all sorts of other areas, all sorts of other parts of an audio system. And of course, if you got the problems with silver has is that it is very good at highlighting the flaws elsewhere. So if you take a random system and put silver wires in it, it'll most likely sound worse. But that's the silver you're listening to. That's the rest of the system has suddenly had the window cleaned. And now you can hear much more of what's wrong within the system. And then, of course, it's much easier to go into denial and say, well, silver is very expensive, actually, and I don't like the sound of what it does. So I'm not going to investigate why it doesn't sound, why it does what it does.
Yep.
And I think the industry as a whole, the audio industry has proven to be exceptionally blinkered and biased and uninterested in really pursuing better quality through improved materials.
Which is something Audionote, because as you said, you make your own parts and hand foiled.
I mean, they, you know, if you take this, for example, I don't know whether you can see it. Can you see it?
Yes, I can.
Okay. Now that's, you know what a black gate is?
Yes, of course.
Now this is essentially, we have a working relationship with Rubicon now, where we are redeveloping a better version of the black gates than the original black gates.
Wow.
This is taking some time and it's costing
a lot of money.
A lot of money. So as an intermediate development, we developed the one I just showed you. And that's basically what it is. It's a black gate, but without the carbonized paper. So it's got the same electrolyte, it's got the same foil, and it's got the same paper. It's just that the paper has not been impregnated with graphite particles.
Okay.
And this really does sound remarkably good.
Oh, there are a lot of people. I mean, you've got Gordon Rankin of Wavelength Audio and USB DAX who swears by black gates, as do many others. Yeah, and now with them gone out of the system.
They won't, when they run out, they won't be able to get any more.
Mm-hmm.
We're doing a, what we'll eventually, I mean, it's taken, we are on the fourth, in year four now, doing the work with Rubicon. But we, at the end of this development, it'll have cost us somewhere between $750,000 and $1 million. And that's before we even have any product.
That's true. That's just R&D.
That's just the R&D, and it's working out, you know. Do we use this process for the paper? Do we use that process? There are a number of processes where you can impregnate the paper with the graphite particles. And they give very different results. Some of them are clearly better and some of them are clearly worse. And the problem is that the ones that are better are the ones that the paper manufacturers don't want to do. Hmm. Because they're filthy processes. Graphite powder gets everywhere.
Wow. You know?
And it takes the original company that made the Blackgate paper, they stopped because they were finding that they ran I ran a batch of paper for which took a day to produce, and then they needed to spend a week cleaning the machine because otherwise they couldn't use it for anything else.
Oh, okay.
And of course, Blackgate was only, or Gelmax, as the company that made the Blackgates were called, they were only paying for the paper that they were receiving. They were not paying for all the shit that had to be cleaned up afterwards, because that was never added to the bill.
Oh, yeah, because you need to retool. My dad's into manufacturing, and my dad actually designs large factories, literally for the clothes industry, from everyone from Ralph Lauren to Polo to on and on. And one of his factories, it's like they offered him an order. This'll make your mind blown. 144 gross. And they turned down the order because it's not worth it to retool the factory to only make 144 gross of a product. It's expensive to retool up and down for something.
No, but you know, you can imagine that the company that made the paper in Japan, you know, we went and saw them, Andy Grove and I, and sat down with them. And unfortunately, by then they had dismantled the machine. Because it's an old-fashioned style machine that makes this. And they dismantled the machine, and they were not willing to put it back together again. And, you know, we said to them, well, you know, if you're prepared to put it back together again, we're perfectly happy to pay for that. We're perfectly happy to pay for the cost of making the paper and whatever 10 days it takes to clean the machine up and so on. But they just weren't willing to do that. So we're now talking to three other paper manufacturers in Japan about the various processes, and we're testing different types of paper with different. I've got a whole stack of prototypes that we're listening to and have listened to see which process brings us further down the road. And of course, I've still got about $1 million worth of Blackgates in stock, which means that I can still produce products of the current quality without compromising on that, although we are beginning to run out of certain types.
Right, so you're looking at the future. Now, let's move on to something else which is pretty original from AudioNote, and that is your turntable, the new TT3, which is a three-motor turntable, which followed, obviously, Void that you used to carry. Now, why three motors? Everyone else is into a single motor, or they're into some type of pulley or direct. Because, as you know, vinyl LPs are taking off again, really popular. Why three motors?
Well, one, because I'm a strong believer in the suspended chassis turntable, where you basically isolate the playing part, if you will, the plat on the arm, with a set of springs. And in order to get a good balance on those, you need to have the springs in a set up in a way that gives the bounce, if you will. This was something Lin and some of the other turntable manufacturers in the 70s were very heavily into. In fact, I think Edgar Wiltshire was the first one to mention this when he designed the original A&R turntable in 57 or whenever the heck it was he designed this thing. So in order to create good balance and good isolation, you need a low resonance frequency, you need a stable bounce, and the best way of doing that without having the suspension fight the motor is to have three motors. Two motors is sort of okay, three motors is ideal. And the other thing that three motors allow you to do is to reduce the mass of the platter to almost nothing, because you're storing the energy in the motor. Rather than storing it as inertia in a heavy platter. And heavy platters have some very distinct disadvantages in terms of their overall behavior.
Now the other factor, if I might bring in, is unlike smaller power supplies, and we're looking at the three really large power supplies, you pay a lot of attention also to the power supply, which almost mimics a power amplifier we do for our speakers.
Yeah, well, we actually do, because Pabst have stopped making their big motors quite a few years ago, and we've actually run out now. We don't have any more big motors or the medium-sized motors for the half reference. We are now looking at making our own motor.
Hmm.
And it'll probably be some kind of hybrid between an AC and a DC motor. I've got the design in at the moment, the theoretical design. We haven't actually built one yet, so the theoretical design may turn out to be wasted space.
Well, that's a little sneak peek for our viewers then.
You patent out on it because it has some efficiency improvements, at least in theory. And of course, if it works in practice, then it would be worth taking a patent out on.
Hmm. So any other news or anything else you'd like us to cover? Or you'd like to say, Peter?
Well, we've nearly finished the design on the non-magnetic resistor range. We have two versions. We have one with a copper brass end cap and copper wire outs. And then we have one which we are just about to start production of, which are with solid silver end caps and solid silver wire outs. They're horribly expensive. We had to develop a special type of annealable silver for that, which took several years. I think it took nearly 3 years it took over a year to find a company that would even talk to us about it. Because people just went, why do you want that? Nobody else uses this, but this is the whole point. Otherwise, we wouldn't need it to be developed, would we now?
The interesting part of AudioNode in general is that, you know, a lot of what people aren't willing to do, whether it's handmade silver foil resistors or on and on, you just keep pioneering and investing R&D, and then you release these staggering products that really do sound amazing.
Well, yeah, but I'd like to think they do, because otherwise all the effort we put into it would really be worth the
Ah, oh, true that. Well, I definitely want to thank you for your time.
Am I running out of time now?
No, we have a few more minutes. We're about 22 in, so go ahead. Feel free. Yours.
We're starting production on the silver resistors. And that project is gonna end up costing us somewhere in the region of £500,000, which is what, $750,000?
Yes.
We'll get the first batch of resistors, we get about 12,000 resistors. So that's quite if you sort of divide it down over the first 12,000 resistors, they make some pretty expensive resistors. The other thing that we've just finished is a discrete DAC using tantalum resistors. And that is showing, the prototype of that is showing fantastic promise. It really is. I'm not a big fan of digital, as you know.
Mm-hmm. I've seen your record collection in your house. It's huge. Your other collection in a, we won't say where, but let me just inform the viewers who might not know, I have been the Peter's super secret stash, and I won't give you more details, but between your tube stash and your vinyl stash, I am just in awe. I so admire you.
Well, the tube stash is about five times the size of what it was when you saw it.
Oh my God.
The record stash is not quite, it is about the same as it's always been. Hmm. No, the it's called an R2R ladder. And we've discovered some things because we didn't initially think that this was going to work. Because on a theoretical level, it doesn't really, you know, what should we say, infuse you with great confidence that if you spend the time building a prototype, that it's actually going to work.
Hmm.
And we hired an engineer in Croatia who had been experimenting along the same lines privately with this. And he brought over a prototype he'd built, and it was very rough at the edges, and you know, there were lots of issues with it. It had funny, made funny noises and did all sorts of things. Hmm. But there was something about the sound that I have never heard, even from the best DACs that we make now. And that made me, one, hire him as a permanent member of staff, and two, put in a project. And about 8 weeks ago, he finished the first version for us, where Andy had designed the power supply and the logic gate system. And I have to say, we do not currently make any DACs that are as good as this. And this is, given that this prototype could probably be sold for maybe $20,000, that's not saying a little.
Wow.
So this is giving me a slight headache in the sense that, you know, what do I do with all the DACs that I've sold over the last year or two to people that have spent, you know, $100,000 plus on a DAC? And we've sold quite a lot of those. So the decision has already been made that if we can get this to work and we're happy with the performance in an absolute sense, then they'll have to send their DACs back and we'll modify them for free.
Wow. That is amazing.
Well, you can't ask people to, in my view at least, you can't ask people to trust you as a manufacturer if you sell them something that's really very, very expensive indeed, and they then come back, and you then come back to them 18 months later and you say, hey man, I just made something, I didn't really investigate this properly, I made something that's much, much better now. You're going to have to spend $50,000 or $30,000 or $20,000 or $10,000 on having this 18-month-old product upgraded. I think that's completely, to me, that's completely unacceptable. I mean, I would never buy something if a manufacturer did this to me, which is another reason why I drive old Mercedes cars and wear old watches and things like this, because I think most of the new stuff is just rubbish.
Yeah. I have to admit I have a weakness for these old watches you refer to and whatnot as well. So I'm as guilty as you are.
I'll email you the pictures of the Mercs I've been buying the past 6 months. You'll die and think you've gone to heaven.
Oh, you're such a tease. okay, so I guess we should round this up. We're almost 30 minutes in, which is about 20 minutes longer than it should be.
Well, that's all right. We, you know, we have a lot to say and no time within to say.
I'll tell you what, let's cap this off with what would be your three favorite vinyl albums? Because I know you give us, it doesn't matter how rare they are, what are your three favorite albums?
When you say favorite, you mean musically favorite? Or
musically, not sound. This is the other thing. Favorite. You don't go for sound quality over musically.
My favorite cello album is the early period label. Janos Starker plays the Kudai Sonata. It is the most staggering cello sound I have ever heard, and it's the best playing. Another one would be Atelka Freund plays Chopin. I think this was recorded around 1950 when she was about 70 years old. Wow. She was a pupil of Brahms and Busoni, and her playing is so extraordinary. I only have one copy, and I think she made only maybe one or two recordings. It's on the Plymouth label. I don't know whether you ever heard of it. I had not heard of it when I found this record. And I've got a lot of records. And the third one, you'd have to go and it would be my favorite version of the Tchaikovsky Violin Concerto, which is Bronislav Huberman on Electrola, I think it is the label, 1929.
Wow.
And from a musical standpoint, that is so far superior to anything that's been recorded since then, good as some of those performances are, that it stands alone.
Well, I guess our viewers are going to have to hunt those down and watch the prices rise even further to ridiculous.
Right, actually, I found a couple of copies on eBay a little while ago. They were not that they're like $50 a piece.
Oh, but that's not bad in today's dollars.
But the Starker Kodai Sonata, I think you'll find a somewhat more expensive entity to find. The last copy I saw was about... There's some re-releases of them that you have to watch out for. But the really early ones have a sort of very coarse cardboard sleeve and quite poor printing.
Hmm.
And they're either sort of a light green or a light purple, I think it is. And there you're looking at $500 to $800 for a decent copy.
Wow. Well, I definitely want to thank you very much.
You can afford it.
I'm sorry, what was that?
I said you're a man of means, you can afford it.
Oh, well, the last service in the car included an engine out. We won't go there. Thank you very, very much, Peter, for taking your time. I always love spending time with you. You're wonderful to be with.
All right, my friend.
Thank you. And to our viewers, I'd like to say thanks for watching. My name is Stephen Rochlin with enjoythemusic.tv. And as always, in the end, what really matters is that you enjoy the music.